This film is about a simple question. A simple question with a surprisingly complex answer. A surprisingly complex answer concerning the treatment of vulnerable victims of domestic violence. The treatment of vulnerable victims of domestic violence, informed by policies and practices that promote discrimination on the basis of numerous protected characteristics. Policies and practices promoting discrimination on the basis of numerous protected characteristics that result in starkly different outcomes for users of a countrywide service paid for by the British taxpayer. Policies and practices that point to serious implications for those concerned with laws governing child protection and adult safeguarding services. Policies and practices that, I believe, cannot be objectively justified under the Equality Act 2010. And what's more, have in fact been illegal in this country since 1975. This film is about arguably the most overt example of structural and attitudinal discrimination currently sanctioned and paid for by the British state. Most importantly, this film is about pointing towards a better answer to one very simple question.
In the last week, the National Domestic Abuse Helpline reported a 120% increase in the number of calls it received in one 24-hour period. And I'm launching a new national communications campaign to reach out to those who are at risk from abuse, highlighting that they can still leave home to get the support that you need. It will signpost victims in terms of how they can access help, but also to reassure them by making sure that they can access the services that they need at this particular time. And importantly, it will tell them that they are not alone.
The Prime Minister has announced the most drastic limits to our lives that the UK has ever seen in living memory. The aim, he says, is to save lives in this time of national emergency.
On Monday, the 20th of March 2020, Prime Minister Boris Johnson addressed the nation to announce an unprecedented suspension of civil liberties that would have implications for every single person living in the UK. Most people around the country quickly appeared to signal that the enactment and enforcement of sweeping emergency powers with the backing of the entire UK Parliament was probably fair enough as far as it was fair enough in the context of a global pandemic. And yet, most will also have recognised the coercive and controlling undertone present within Boris Johnson's polite instruction. Because on Monday, the 20th of March 2020, Prime Minister Boris Johnson effectively placed the majority of UK citizens in an undetermined period of house arrest. One of the numerous implications of this action was that it immediately placed an enhanced duty of care directly onto his government and onto Parliament as a whole, requiring them to take action to protect vulnerable people adversely impacted by the instruction to stay at home, to only venture outside for short periods if absolutely necessary, and for an extremely limited set of reasons. Vulnerable people, such as children and adults, experiencing domestic violence in their home.
Shocking statistics have revealed that domestic violence has surged since the start of the coronavirus lockdown, with Charity Refuge reporting a 700% increase, 700% increase in calls to their helpline, and that within just a single day.
Within days, the Home Secretary had clarified that victims of violence could legally leave their homes to get the support they need. And she also launched a new public awareness campaign under the hashtag, You Are Not Alone.
But obviously, because people are trapped at home, they're stuck at home, they're using other means of communication, such as the helpline, such as the online services, such as the helpline that which is up on your screen right now, to actually seek support. So the refuges, the charities themselves, are working flat out, and they're doing an amazing job right now. And they're working across the country, and it's both for men, it's both for women, and also for children who too are victims, to make sure that they are not alone, that they are being safeguarded, that they're getting the help and support that they need right now because of this crisis. And of course, it's fair to say that there'll be more money coming, and this is something that I've been speaking to the sector about when we move forward, because obviously I'm speaking today, you know, about the money that we just announced over the weekend, but over weeks ahead, as this crisis moves into different phases and stages, we will see other funds and other issues and other problems, basically, that will materialise through domestic abuse.
One problem that was immediately apparent, certainly to me, when listening to the Home Secretary's reassurances, was the problem of numerous barriers that male victims of domestic abuse have reported when attempting to seek help from statutory services. Not least the concern that many have voiced that they are reluctant to even seek help in the first place for fear of being treated like a perpetrator of the very crime they had become a victim of. And it also struck me that the reassurances that the Home Secretary had offered to the general public, reassurances repeated by numerous public figures in the days that followed, could in fact be perceived as extremely misleading indeed. Consider this similar statement from London's Victims Commissioner, who is responsible for enabling victims to access a timely, effective, transparent, and inclusive justice journey, and whose personal mantra is that all victims of crime, no matter their status or experience, should be able to get the help that they need.
You can also call the National Domestic Abuse Helpline. They're available 24/7 and can take your calls on 0808 2000 247. And they'll offer you non-judgmental advice, support and information.
Happily, I was far from the only person to question the accuracy of the claim that the National Domestic Violence Helpline for England and Wales offers non-judgmental advice, support and information to anyone who needs help. One such person was psychologist Deborah Parney, herself a survivor of domestic violence, who in the early weeks of lockdown started a very simple campaign on social media that very effectively helped to illustrate the quite extraordinary layers of first silence and then doublespeak that one can be confronted with when attempting to get a straight answer to a very simple question about a national publicly funded service.
But obviously, because people are trapped at home, they're stuck at home, they're using other means of communication, such as the helpline, such as the online services, such as the helpline that which is up on your screen right now, to actually seek support. So the refuges, the charities themselves, are working flat out, and they're doing an amazing job right now. And they're working across the country, and it's both for men, it's both for women, and also for children who too are victims, to make sure that they are not alone, that they are being safeguarded, that they're getting the help and support that they need right now.
So I just asked for clarity from the key players, and I'm asking the question, is this a national helpline that also provides help for men?
Yes.
The second question is, and when they phone, how does that phone call go?
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. I'm not asking about ideology. I'm not asking about where your funding's coming from. I'm asking two really, really simple questions. Now, that should not be an issue. The answer should be, yes, we, of course, as a national domestic abuse helpline, when they call, this is what we do. We make sure that they're safe. We make sure that there's people involved. We make sure their children are safe. It's a really simple answer.
Unless, of course, it's not, which obviously it isn't. Otherwise, I wouldn't have had to make this film, and it wouldn't have taken 31 days of polite, patient, but persistent tweeting for Deborah Parney to receive a response. An entire month of polite, patient, persistent tweeting, during which time Deborah's simple question was posed to a number of relevant public officials, including the Domestic Abuse Commissioner, the Victims Commissioner, the London Victims Commissioner, the Minister for Safeguarding, the Shadow Minister for Domestic Violence and Safeguarding, and also Chair of the All-Party Parliamentary Group on Domestic Violence, the entire Home Affairs Committee, who had just put out a call for evidence to inform an inquiry into the impact of COVID-19 on victims of domestic and child abuse, the minister responsible for the Equalities Office, and the Prime Minister's Office. It may have been unrealistic to expect an answer from all of them, but having personally prepared short videos personally drawing each of their attention to one seemingly simple question, it would have been nice to have received at least one reply. Nevertheless, the campaign did eventually elicit responses from the two organisations primarily responsible for the helpline, namely the domestic violence charity Refuge, who deliver the service, and the Home Office, who pay for it out of the public purse. A response from the Home Office took considerably longer, so let's first consider the response that Deborah Parney finally received from the domestic violence charity Refuge at the 31st time of asking. Although, confusingly, and even though they had well over a month to prepare their answer, they ended up providing her with two. Initially, they advised that the National Domestic Abuse Helpline is branded as a women's helpline. However, if we do receive calls from men, our staff will always listen, risk assess, address any safeguarding issues, and validate the experience. They will then refer them to the men's advice line, which provides specialist support for men. But for some reason, and sometime later, they deleted this response and changed their answer to this. The National Domestic Abuse Helpline, which Refuge runs, is staffed 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. If male callers contact us, we refer them immediately to the Men's Advice Line, which is a specialist service for male victims of domestic abuse. We'll return to their initial response in a little bit, but for now, let's consider what I guess we can describe as their preferred public position. When someone phones the National Domestic Violence Helpline for assistance, if they are female, they are offered non-judgmental advice, support, and information. And if they are male, they are told to phone an entirely different service run by an entirely different service provider that is equipped to provide specialized support to people like them. And bear in mind that their call is not transferred directly to the specialist service. They're told that the National Domestic Violence Helpline does not help men, so they have to phone an entirely different service to the one that the Home Secretary had told them to call. And they have to call it on a weekday because, unlike the National Domestic Violence Helpline, the Men's Advice Line is not available 24/7, 7 days a week.
And then finally, I would also say to anybody who needs any kind of support or help, please don't hesitate to contact the National Domestic Abuse Helpline on 0808 2000 247, because the government, and we are very keen to support the government's message, that there is help available for people who need it.
Some of you may now be thinking that this is a stone-cold example of direct sex discrimination and less favourable treatment in the provision of publicly paid for services to the general public, something which has been illegal in England and Wales since 1975. While others may think, well, it's not really, because after all there is a separate and similar service available to men. So to clarify, according to the Sex Discrimination Act and its successor, the Equality Act 2010, less favourable treatment means that you have been treated differently to someone else solely on the basis of your sex, and you are worse off because of it.
As someone who is interested in recovery and victims, it's terrifying that somebody could reach out for help,
yeah,
and then have their life destroyed. And I'm not being over dramatic here, because when you're in a situation like that, and I am talking from experience, okay, when you're in a situation where you are at rock bottom, you believe everything that your abuser has told you, you believe that you're worthless, you believe that you deserve the stuff that's coming to you, and your whole 24/7 attitude is that it is constantly there, it monopolizes every single part of cognition, which is one of the reasons people don't leave, because you don't have enough brain space to actually think about how you're going to get out the door, because you're too busy trying to formulate a plan of getting through the day. And they're going to pick the phone up, and then that's going to happen to them. It's not over dramatic to say the end of a rope is an option.
And that,
and it terrifies me. It terrifies me, and it angers me.
And to clarify, psychologist Deborah Parney isn't talking about the inconvenience of being told to call a different number. She's talking about what happens next.
Do we have any reason to believe that callers to male domestic violence service helplines are treated differently from those catering for women? And the answer is very much yes.
Yeah.
Because there is a standard and for how you should treat male callers domestic helplines, which is issued by the charity Respect.
Yes.
And it's specific to how you treat male callers. So it's the Respect toolkit for working with male victims. There are good things in the document, by the way, but a great deal of it is specifically about vetting male callers in case they are perpetrators masquerading as victims.
Yes.
So if you look at it, you can identify section after section where this implication is made. So section 2.4, section 4, section 4.2, section 7, section 7.3, and on it goes. Let me read you just one of them. Section 2.4, you will find that perpetrators of domestic violence perceive themselves to be the victims. This is a very common strategy, unconscious or conscious, for perpetrators to use, and one which they may use very effectively. If we don't have ways of identifying who is doing what to whom and with what consequences. Commonly, perpetrators whose partners have used some form of self-defense or violence resistance will identify themselves as primary victims in that moment. So that's one example, but this is throughout the whole document. It's very much focused on precisely this issue of vetting or screening. There's a checklist of 23 questions in section 4.4. And these questions require you to provide, that is, require the caller to provide evidence, either evidence for or evidence against the question being asked. How are you supposed to provide evidence over a phone? I don't know, but they require evidence. Now, if you look at those 23 questions, you find that only about, I think about five questions in the checklist are actually about the abuse that the man may have suffered. The other 17 questions or 18 questions are about the man as perpetrator. So they're asking pointed questions about, well, have you been abusive? Or alternatively, questions that are examining whether his claims are credible, or whether in fact, you know, there's evidence there that he might be telling porkers. So you've got five questions on the plus side, if you like, and 17 or so on the negative side.
Yes.
And yet as part of these Twitter exchanges that Deborah Pony has been involved with, Respect, the organisation that produces this toolkit for working with male victims, was asked the question, about screening. And they can flatly denied it. You'll have the quote, I'm sure. But
yeah, well,
they said that, no, we don't screen. We don't screen callers. No one has to prove that they're a victim of domestic abuse. But clearly, if you're being asked 23 questions and you're asked to provide evidence, what's the difference between that and being asked to prove you're a victim? In fact, you don't just have to prove you're a victim as a man. You have to also prove you're not a perpetrator. You have to do both.
Yes.
So it's very hard to see respect's response to that pointed question about vetting as, well, at best, misdirection, let's say.
I chair a weekly call with all of our national helplines and main services for domestic abuse. And on that call, I'm joined with officials from government departments. And I suppose, you know, the obvious thing to say about domestic abuse and the COVID epidemic is what a deadly combination it really is.
So when someone calls the National Domestic Abuse Helpline, they're provided with non-judgmental advice, support and information. Unless they are identified as male, where one of two things possibly happens. They're either risk assessed to address any safeguarding issues and to validate their experience, and then told to contact an entirely different service run by an entirely different service provider, better equipped to provide specialized support to people like them. Or they're immediately told to contact an entirely different service run by an entirely different service provider, better equipped to provide specialized support to people like them. And when they contact the men's advice line, they will be offered advice, emotional support, and signposting to other vital services, if available in their area, by an advice line operator who has been trained to perceive callers presenting as a victim to potentially be an actual perpetrator of domestic abuse. Their conversation will be treated as confidential unless the operator has reason to believe that a perpetrator of domestic abuse poses a particular risk, in which case they will share that information with respective social services and or the police and his partner or ex-partner when the risk is immediate and severe.
Home should be a place of love and of safety, but for more than 2 million people last year, it was not. In these extraordinary times of lockdown and social distancing, we know that domestic abuse is not only continuing, but for many, sadly, it is getting even worse than it was before. And to show our support for victims of domestic abuse and to spread the message that help and support is still available, we are using this symbol, a palm print with a heart on it, to show that everybody matters with domestic abuse. You are not alone. And if you ask for help, you will get it.
At this point, I should stress that not all services operating support to men adopt such an approach or perceive men's needs to be distinctly different to the needs of female victims of abuse. The Mankind Initiative, who offer a countrywide helpline service, is one such example and appear to adopt a non-judgmental approach, much more similar to the one adopted by the National Domestic Abuse Helpline when providing services to female members of the general public. If you or someone you know is ever in need of non-judgmental advice and support, you can contact them at the number on your screen. So having established that people who contact the National Domestic Abuse Helpline will experience dramatically different outcomes depending solely on their sex, and that apart from relatively narrow exceptions to the rule, direct sex discrimination has been illegal in England and Wales since 1975. The next obvious question to ask is, are the Home Office's current arrangements fit for purpose, and could they actually be breaking the law? And you may not be surprised to hear that the answer to that question is a little bit complicated and confusing. But thankfully, we do have a legal precedent for anyone struggling to point their moral compass in the right direction.
The helpline is run by Refuge, which is a woman's charity.
Yeah.
So there's no, you would think, no problem in principle with them extending their services also to men. But there's a history here in terms of services being provided to the two sexes. And perhaps I can pick up the story in 2017.
Please, yeah.
When Welsh grandmother Anna Reagan asked a question of the EHRC, the Equalities and Human Rights Commission, specifically the Welsh office, about a domestic violence charity in Wales called the Dean Project, which is a specific male supporting charity. And the question she asked is because she'd become aware of the fact that they seem to be using a vetting process on their callers.
Okay.
So rather than simply taking at face value a man phoning the helpline and saying, I'm the victim of domestic abuse, can you help me? They were applying a procedure that that was clearly questioning whether that was the case or whether actually he was a perpetrator of domestic violence posing as a victim. The basis of her concern to the EHRC was inequitable treatment between men and women phoning helplines in the context of domestic abuse. Because as far as we're aware, at least, when women phone a domestic abuse helpline, they don't get exposed to this degree of suspicion. They don't get vetted or screened. So that was the question that Anna Reagan asked. And the initial response from the EHRC was essentially to deny there was any problem. And the response they made, let me just quote the specific response. It says, the Dean Project provides support to heterosexual, gay, bisexual and trans men who are experiencing domestic abuse from a partner. The Dean Project has developed 5 guiding principles for its work with men. These include that a clear screening protocol is essential in order to identify and respond appropriately to counter allegations. Screening is not commonplace within services for women because women constitute the overwhelming majority of those abused. That was the initial response in early in 2017.
Which is clearly showing a direct difference of treatment.
Absolutely. We could discuss how credible we find the reasoning there. Personally, I don't find it credible merely to claim that one group of people are the majority of those that suffer a particular type of abuse, therefore we can treat the minority differently. Seems to be remarkably spurious logic. If you follow that logic, you'd screen ethnic minorities that phoned helplines, and I'm sure no one would want to go there. So
That's the analogy, isn't it?
But that's not how it ended up, because Anna Reagan is made of sterner stuff, and continue to press the matter with the help of an assembly member. And eventually the EHRC in Wales took external legal advice. And based on that external legal advice, later on in 2017, they came out with a very different position. And their response then, the key part of it, was this. Our view is that a policy of screening male but not female callers to an advice line is likely to constitute direct discrimination in breach of Section 13 of the Equality Act 2010. Although women comprise the overwhelming majority of victims of domestic abuse, this does not mean that a comparison between the way men and women are treated by the providers of the helpline is not a comparison between similarly situated individuals, which strikes me as perfectly reasonable.
And, you know, having a reasonable understanding of the Equality Act, relatively obvious as well, I would have thought.
We're extremely worried about this problem. We've launched the You Are Not Alone campaign to help people get the support that they need. We recognised straight away that this was one of the major issues with the lockdown, that it would put domestic violence victims at potentially more risk of abuse. You should leave that home if you're able to. We've also launched the campaign on the National Domestic Abuse Helpline number, which is 0808 2000 247. And people should ring that with a view to getting the help they need.
So having identified a relatively obvious example of state-sponsored structural and institutional discrimination operating in plain sight at the heart of government and in front of so many public officials who you might expect would have been trained to know better, you may now be wondering how this sort of carry-on is accepted, championed even, by politicians and government departments close to 50 years since direct discrimination became illegal in law. And to understand this fully, we need to consider two relatively narrow exceptions to that law, and most particularly, the approach that several instruments of state have adopted when seeking to meet their duty of care to women, men, and perhaps most importantly, children at risk of experiencing violence in the home. Perhaps pragmatically, over the years, successive UK governments have adopted something of a public-private partnership approach, and through the country's network of local councils, have sought to meet their responsibilities by contracting the services of existing domestic abuse infrastructure on the ground that has been developed by a country-wide patchwork of often small local charities. Perhaps pragmatically, because not only does this provide the appearance of working in partnership with existing and experienced practitioners already engaging with victims of abuse on the ground, but it can also be perceived to save a lot of public money when compared with the option of delivering services directly through the public sector. Just by way of example, in 2016, the New Economics Foundation estimated that if refuges services were not available to the general public, it would cost the state an additional £5.9 million a year to meet the public need met by that one charity alone.
Domestic abuse accounts for a third of violent crime. And as one of my other honourable friends referenced in an intervention, it is estimated to cost our society £66 billion a year. This is not something that simply takes place behind closed doors and that others can ignore. It is something that affects us all. It affects our economy. It affects our society. It affects our young people as they are growing up.
Pragmatic, but also problematic. Because it has long since been recognised that this approach has led to a postcode lottery for victims of abuse, with a starkly uneven distribution and sometimes complete absence of specialised support services across nations and regions of the UK. A problem that in 2019, then Prime Minister Theresa May vowed to end by imposing a legal duty on local councils to provide secure accommodation and appropriate support services for victims of abuse. A legal duty that will be more than a little problematic for local councils to deliver in an equitable manner, because over the years the state has been contracting services from a patchwork of domestic violence service providers that to a fair extent regard themselves as being developed and run by women exclusively for the benefit of other women. Service providers that are all too often entirely comfortable with the non-egalitarian notion of entirely cutting men loose.
Shadow Minister Jess Phillips.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. COVID-19 has laid bare the lack of protection for women and girls from violence. The lockdown has allowed the public to imagine what it would be like if your home, a supposed place of safety, contained the danger you feared most. The only qualification for access to support, housing, refuge, social security, and police protection for victims of domestic abuse in this country should be, are you human?
A layperson listening to that impassioned speech by the Shadow Minister for Safeguarding and Domestic Violence, chair of the all-party parliamentary group on domestic violence, and former business development manager for Women's Aid.
It happens to men too, you know.
It happens to men.
Do you want the a point? It happens to men as the well. Men. Oh, men. Yeah, okay.
Might easily be left with the impression that the honourable member is of the view that the only qualification criteria for access to support, housing, refuge, social security and police protection for victims of domestic violence should be, are you human? Granted, there are currently restrictions impacting on migrant workers, asylum seekers and others, but more obviously, in reality, the main qualification criteria for access to support, housing, refuge, social security and public protection for victims of domestic violence can very often be, are you female? And the main reason for this is that highly influential people like the Shadow Minister for Safeguarding and Domestic Violence, chair of the all-party parliamentary group on domestic violence, and former business development manager for Women's Aid,
it happens to men too, you know,
regard men as an entirely different species to the women they claim to exclusively seek to serve.
You wouldn't ring up, what I always say to people is, oh well, it's not fair that a man can't stay in this refuge. It's like ringing up the Cats Protection League and saying, I've got this dog. Like, well, I suggest you open a dog shelter.
They also believe that women like them are almost entirely responsible for creating and funding the infrastructure that has grown to become known as the violence against women and girls sector.
And it often happens when you talk about Women's Aid, people are like, oh, well, where's Men's Aid? I'm like that. Well, tell you what, get a squat, put a mattress on the floor, have jumble sales for the entirety of the 80s, which was how we funded the women's movement, and then maybe we'll take you seriously.
It's difficult to take such a statement seriously when you consider the reality that earlier this year, the Violence Against Women and Girls sector issued a joint statement demanding that £65 million of taxpayers' money should be ring-fenced exclusively for them to address the dual pandemics of COVID-19 and violence against women and girls. That's on top of the millions already ring-fenced and channeled towards their respective organisations on an annual basis. But it becomes even harder when you consider the testimony of someone like Erin Pizzey, the woman who actually started throwing down those mattresses all the way back in the 1970s, and is widely recognised as not only the mother of the women's refuge movement, but also the founder of the charity that would eventually become the UK's preferred service provider for the National Domestic Abuse Helpline.
So when she's busy saying that in the 80s they were doing jumble sales, that's rubbish. 1974 was the date when all of us lost the control over the narrative on domestic violence. And Jess Phillips is one of the stupid women, or cunning women, who know that this is a cash cow for women. So out of this comes the mantra, all women are innocent victims of men's violence. And that now, next year is the 50th year that I opened the refuge.
Yeah.
And that 50 years has been used against men and boys and the family, and it was planned.
One fact largely lost to history is that the first ever employee of the charity that became Refuge, and indeed the first person in the entire UK ever paid to work in a women's refuge, was actually male and was specifically selected by the women who lived there because they wanted a positive male role model to work with their children. The appointment predates the introduction of the Sex Discrimination Act, but ironically, it would almost certainly qualify for a narrow exception allowed under it that permits employers to restrict jobs to someone of a particular sex for a very limited number of reasons. Ironically, because over the decades that followed, and alongside something called the charities exception, charities like Refuge have utilised these two narrow exceptions to the rule to the extent that they have been allowed to develop a sector-wide culture, service practice and working environment where they quite literally wouldn't have a man about the place.
So at Refuge, we run the National Domestic Abuse Helpline, which is a free phone 24/7 service. Funding from government that's announced couldn't be more welcome, and our absolute priority is that funding there's a sufficient portion ring fence for violence against women and girls services. Now we really need to coordinate that to make sure that the risks to women and girls and what they need is being taken into account at the very highest level of decision making.
One reason why the UK government's preferred specialist National Domestic Abuse Helpline provider choose not to offer assistance to men is because they believe that the overwhelming majority of victims of domestic violence are female and the overwhelming majority of perpetrators are male. They also believe that domestic violence exists as part of patriarchal social structures and is an intentional pattern of behaviour utilised by men to establish and maintain power and control over a female partner or ex-partner. Both beliefs are ideological infused hokum and are in fact provably false. And yet successive British governments have accepted both theories to be true to the extent that they have helped to shape a strategy to address domestic violence experienced by women and girls that effectively cuts male victims loose. A strategy that also makes it extremely difficult for male-positive charities like the Mankind Initiative to compete for public funding because application criteria currently require charities to not only show how they contribute to local strategies for ending violence against women and girls, but also how they take a strategic approach to acknowledging the gendered nature of violence.
But to go back to Jess Phillips, which is why I call her the stand-up artist and a liar, because she's claiming facts that are actually not true.
Yes.
By the 1980s, the Women's Aid was very heavily, and also Refuge, was very heavily subsidised. Now it's around, I think it's around 300 million altogether that goes to both organisations. And okay. Sandra Hawley, who took over from my Refuge, I lost my Refuge, she gets paid £220,000 a year.
Yeah.
That's more than the Prime Minister.
You know, I want you, everyone, to be in no doubt. I want every victim of domestic abuse, domestic violence, domestic abuse of every kind. And as I say, they're overwhelmingly, but not exclusively, female. I want every woman to know, every female person in this country, to know she is not alone. She's not alone. And I also want every perpetrator of domestic abuse and violence, and they are overwhelmingly male, I want them to know that they won't get away with it.
And to understand just how ingrained discriminatory practices have become within public authorities due to the ideological demands of the violence against women and girls sector, consider the Ministry for Housing's criteria for accessing the Domestic Abuse Safe Accommodation COVID-19 Emergency Support Fund. To begin with, it establishes a requirement that any provision for male victims is located separately from women's services within dedicated men's services. This might be regarded as entirely fair enough, as far as it's fair enough, but one outcome of such stark sex segregation of services is that most emergency safe accommodation service providers simply do not offer services to men. The Ministry for Housing do indicate that when considering applications, they will give special consideration to services that provide specialist safe accommodation. And yet they define this as accommodation providing dedicated specialist support to victims with relevant protected characteristics, such as people with disabilities, people from a black and minority ethnic background, and people from the LGBT community. The absence of men in the ministry's list of recognised groups in need of specialist support may very well go some way to explaining why, at the start of the pandemic, there was not one single safe accommodation bed available to men in the entire Greater London area, be they black and minority ethnic, disabled, gay, bisexual, transgender, or otherwise. But perhaps even more shockingly, consider the Ministry's understanding of the meaning of dispersed accommodation. Because for the purposes of access to government funding, dispersed accommodation is defined as safe, self-contained accommodation with the same level of specialist domestic abuse support as provided within a refuge, but which may be more suitable for victims who are unable to stay in a refuge due to complex support needs or for families with teenage sons. which in reality means that the British government is currently entirely prepared to fund service providers who operate the still widespread practice of refusing entry to male children over the age of 12.
And I've had conversations with women that have been in refuge, shelters run by refuge, that have said it was heartbreaking for them having to make the decision to go into their particular shelter because they had to leave their 13-year-old son with someone else. It really breaks my heart because my son is 13 and I've got two stepsons, one of which is 12 and one of which is 15. And I think about them. I can't help but think about them when I think about this situation.
Yeah.
Because I think, can you imagine being a boy that's witnessed this? Let's say we're following the patriarchal model and they've witnessed their father being abusive to them and their mother.
Yeah.
So they flee and they flee to safety and they're out of that situation. And then they walk into a shelter where the shelter goes, oh yes, women, you come in because you're great, but you're not allowed in because you're like your dad. Because that's what they'll hear. I don't care what anyone says, you're one of them and you're going to be like him, so you're not in here. I can't imagine the trauma that that boy would go through. And I can't imagine how a woman must feel thinking, you know, I've got myself out of that. I've ripped myself out of that situation. And now I have to abandon my son.
Morally, this strikes me as an extraordinarily inhuman practice. And like much of the practice outlined in this film, it strikes me as extremely legally dubious as well. Because clearly it is yet another example of direct discrimination against service users solely on the grounds of sex. Presumably, Refuge would argue that as a registered charity, the charity's exception allows them to limit its services to people who share a specific protected characteristic, i.e. women, because their governing document states that it only allows people who share that protected characteristic to benefit from their services. But the problem with this perspective is that their governing document clearly states that their charitable objective is to provide for the relief of women and their children. And for the purposes of child protection, children are classified as anyone who has not yet reached their 18th birthday. And besides, it also states that they also provide relief to other victims, and their website clearly states that they also provide services to men. But there is another even more fundamental reason why, in my humble, subjective, but professionally informed opinion, such practices are almost certainly in breach of the Equality Act 2010. Because funding bodies such as the Home Office and the Ministry of Housing are not registered charities, and therefore cannot rely on the charity's exception when seeking to justify their own policies and practices in this area, and why they allow their chosen service providers to directly discriminate against boys and men. And not only are they bound by the Equality Act's public sector equality duty, which means that they are required by law to show how they have taken proactive action to consider how their actions might affect people protected from direct and indirect sex discrimination, and also take steps to remove or minimise any disadvantage they find, but more significantly, they are also bound by Section 29.6, which states that a person must not, in the exercise of a public function that is not the provision of a service to the public or a section of the public, do anything that constitutes discrimination. A public function like deciding the most effective, equitable and ethical way to distribute monies from the public purse. So with these thoughts in mind, the Glass Blind Spot wrote to the Home Secretary to ask a series of questions relating to what steps her office have taken to ensure that victims of domestic abuse are not being discriminated against on the basis of characteristics protected under the Equality Act 2010, and how they might justify any of their own current practices that directly discriminate against boys and men We also asked them that given the Home Office recommends that service providers working with male victims of abuse should use the Respect Male Victims Toolkit, what toolkits do they recommend service providers working with female victims use? For added context to that question, I should highlight the fact that the Respect Male Victims Toolkit advises the following.
Respect does not recommend the use of a separate assessment process for male and female victims, as there is a risk that one client group might inadvertently be discriminated against by having to overcome added barriers to receive a service. For example, the organisation should decide that both female and male service users are proactively asked about their use of violence and abuse when assessed, or that neither male or female service users are asked.
A grand total of 74 working days later, we received a reply. A reply that is available on the Glass Blind Spot website, so you can make your own mind up. But disappointingly, at least in my humble subjective opinion, their 5-page, 1,500-word letter failed to acknowledge most of the questions put to them, let alone attempt to offer a coherent answer. So rather than attempt to pick apart the answers that they provided in their place, let's instead move on to the bit where I promised to provide a better answer to the simple question, what happens when someone calls the National Domestic Abuse Helpline? An answer provided by Northern Ireland's Justice Minister, whose office is responsible for delivering a similar, but also markedly different, national helpline to the people of Northern Ireland. Because when the Glass Blind Spot approached her office with a similar set of questions, she advised the following. The Northern Ireland Domestic and Sexual Abuse Helpline, managed by Nexus NI, provides equal support and guidance 24/7 to all victims of domestic and sexual abuse, with no differentiation on the basis of gender. In terms of helpline support, it is disappointing that the service provided to males and females in England and Wales differs significantly. During the early COVID-19 period, 13% of callers to the Northern Ireland helpline were male, which is still less than half of the estimated proportion of male victims based on Police Service of Northern Ireland statistics. But the proportion of callers has already risen significantly since the service was taken over by a service provider adopting a gender-inclusive approach.
I am too ashamed to talk. Everyone who comes to Nexus feels ashamed, but you've nothing to be ashamed of. The shame's not yours, it belongs to the abuser.
A gender-inclusive approach that shows that it is entirely possible to move towards an approach consistent with both the spirit and letter of equality and human rights law, and which seeks to remove outdated and archaic discriminatory practices that could be extremely difficult to justify if challenged in law. And in the short time we have left, I want to conclude by inviting you to briefly consider two recent incidents where someone's home, supposedly a place of safety, contained the danger that they feared most. Because I believe that they both draw attention to the very serious implications of promoting ignorant or ill-informed gender stereotypes about perpetrators and victims of domestic abuse, and the very serious implications of failing to strive towards a better answer to the question that has been the focus of this film. In May of this year, the charred, dismembered remains of a woman were discovered in two separate suitcases hidden in a forest. DNA tests established that the victim was 28-year-old Phoenix Netz, who had been living in a council-owned women's refuge just miles away from Jess Phillips's constituency office. Another resident of the shared and supposedly safe accommodation was subsequently arrested, charged with Phoenix's murder, and will stand trial later this month. Meanwhile, in October, the Manchester Safeguarding Partnership published a number of recommendations following the outcome of a serious case review. The case review was conducted due to concerns regarding how officials had worked together to safeguard a four-month-old infant who had been subject to a child protection plan. In November 2018, paramedics had been called to the infant's home following reports that it was convulsing and had stopped breathing. The child was revived by paramedics at the scene, and following an MRI scan the next day, it was concluded that it had suffered subdural bleeding, consistent with being shaken without an impact. Greater Manchester Police were alerted to the incident and commenced an immediate investigation into the child's injuries, and its mother was subsequently charged with a Section 18 assault, contrary to the Offences Against the Person Act 1861. She pleaded guilty in court and was sentenced to a 20-month prison sentence. The review concluded that social workers had failed to grasp the complex dynamics of domestic abuse within a family where the mother subsequently assaulted her baby, causing serious injury and bleeding on the brain. This was caused by the fact that professionals from children's services and other agencies had made persistent assumptions that the father of the child was the only potential perpetrator of violence within the household, despite clear evidence to the contrary. The review recommended that going forward, child protection planning should approach domestic abuse from a gender-neutral perspective. ONS data indicates that one in every three victims of interpartner violence will be male. Furthermore, the most comprehensive meta-analysis of peer-reviewed domestic violence studies in the UK and North America concluded that 58% of interpersonal violence reported was bidirectional and involved dysfunctional behaviour and violence by both partners. Such realities tell me that it helps no one to promote the outdated stereotype that the overwhelming number of victims are female, and that perpetrators of violence and coercive, controlling behaviours in the home are almost exclusively male.
You have to think of it politically, because they're not interested. You see, this is the thing. Women's Aid and the Federation and Refuge aren't interested in women's issues. If they were, they would be talking about violent women who need care and whose only hope. Because my great sorrow is that we had a long-term project for our violence-prone mothers. They came in, they learned actually how to react to violence and frustration calmly and peacefully. Then they were ready and they shared and they moved on into other, we had other houses, and they moved in with their friends. So they weren't just put out into the cold world as a single parent mother, which they were too vulnerable at that point. They then stayed in the second stage houses until they got rehoused themselves. So that was about 3 years.
Yeah.
And we had houses all over England. And it was a therapeutic program, and it was all smashed and destroyed.